work, just as his own work was supported by H.P. Lovecraft. So he's kind of an Olivian of H.P. Lovecraft. Before becoming a full-time writer, he worked as a garbage man, a private garbage man, a lumber salesman, a copywriter, an editor of the paleontological magazine Fossils, and as a literary agent for Scott Meredith, where he served as agent for author Henry Miller. He also worked in Off-Off-Broadway and Summer Stock as a reviewer, a playwright, and a director. Already an interesting career. In 1980, he published his first novel, Off-Season, which is about a real-life family that lived in a cave, and they had an interesting lifestyle of murder, cannibalism, and incest. Sweet topic for your first book. Mainstream reviewers hated it, but fans felt otherwise. His next publication was Hide and Seek, and more of his successful novels include She Wakes, Cover, Roadkill, aka Joyride, Only Child, also known as Strange Hold, Ladies' Night, and Triage, which is a collection of novellas with fellow writers. And in 1990, he published Offspring, which was a sequel to Offseason. As a writer, he concentrates mainly on real-life monsters, like that family in the first book. But he also writes otherworldly and surreal things, like he has a dark Western novella, The Crossings, and The Haunt is a short supernatural tale. So far, Jack has won the Bram Stoker Award for his short stories, The Box and Gone, and his collections of stories called Closing Time and Peaceable Kingdom. Probably some more awards in the future, I think. You're still going strong, right? Some of the most powerful novels have been turned into films. Red, The Girl Next Door, The Lost, The Woman, and Offspring. And also two of his short stories were made into short films, Mail Order and Olivia. And by the way, you can hear Jack reading an excerpt from Olivia online. If you Google it, you can find it. It's very interesting. He also wrote a book that is part autobiography, part biography, about influential people in his life, and that's called Book of Souls. Welcome, Jack Ketchum, aka Dallas. I guess we'll call you Dallas, because that's your real name. And Stephen King has called him the scariest guy in America. But don't worry, I don't think he bites.
King called me back in the Bush administration. I said it was actually George Bush. Thanks. I hope you guys will pay your taxes. Thanks for coming out such a shit. Okay, this is a short excerpt that I wrote about economy. And see what you think. For me, economy is crucial to really good writing, particularly the onset of your story, particularly in writing suspense. To hell with exposition. You can seek that aim gradually as the story goes along. Right now, at the onset, you want to keep them turning those pages. You want to make them leap right in. As Elmore Leonard famously said when asked how he got his writing so tight, I leave out the parts that people tend to skip. Unless height, weight, hair color, the size of his dick is crucial to your character, leave it the hell out. Unless the landscape is itself a major character, which it is in some books by James Lee Burke, Cormac McCarthy, and others, leave it for later. I think it was the screenwriter and novelist William Goldman who advised writers to start a scene as close to the end of the thing as possible, and that Vonnegut had something to say about that too. Good idea. Skip the buildup and get to the guts of it. Here's the opening paragraph to a story of mine called Bully. So it's all pouring out of him now. He's all over the place. We're done with the weather and the small talk. It's like I've set something loose inside him, which he says he's not spoken of in 20-odd years, and maybe it's his own three scotches to my one, but I think it runs much deeper than that. I think he's speaking about who he is and why. This is a reporter doing an interview. We don't need to know who he is just yet, or even who his interview subject is. Don't need to know where they're sitting, how he got there, what he wants to learn from this man. That comes later. We enter in the middle of something, and it seems important. Economy. Note that this entire paragraph was two sentences. The first one, a long run-on. It's meant to race you through the paragraph without a breather. Long run-ons and short staccato sentences are the poetry of suspense writing. The stressed, unstressed, stressed, the meter. Compare the above lines to these lines from my novel with Lucky McKee, The Woman. There is pain. Pain that pulses through her body from shoulder to knee, that beats at her body as the waves beat the shore. But pain is to be born. This is nothing to the pain of birthing. Pain says one thing only, alive. Short, choppy, nervous-making sentences. Partials. The literary equivalent of stuttering. Just like what I'm writing now. What do these two sentences have in common? Read the selections again. Both are packed with information about the people involved, the comedy. That's the piece. Partials. The literary equivalent of stuttering. Just like what I'm writing now. What do these two sentences have in common? Read the selections again. Both are packed with information about the people involved, the comedy. That's the piece.
Great examples of economy by other authors.
Well, I mean, there's some guys who are just really wonderful at it. I mentioned Elmore Leonard, and if you're writing the kind of stuff that I write, you can't really write unless you write him. He's got 10 rules for writing. One of my favorites is, if it sounds like writing, rewrite it. It's got to actually sound like talk or something in the actual room. There's room for all kinds of stuff. I mean, I guess the major guys in the early 20th century, mid-20th century, Hemingway and Faulkner, they couldn't be more different. You read a Hemingway line and it's up and up and up. You read a Faulkner line and it's smooth, it rides, it flows, it goes all over the place. But even Hemingway did a Faulkner line every now and then just because it was pretty, it sounded right. It's when we're writing, we're really not just talking to people. We're on kind of a seesaw because you're communicating with another person. It's not just about your voice, it's about their voice. Because I dare you to read any book and not have it come out in your voice. You're contributing, the writer's contributing to your voice, to the way you hear it. But essentially, it's your voice that's knocking down every word. And that's the way it translates to you. Does that make any sense at all?
Yes, I think so. All right. I like what you said about if it sounds like writing, rewrite it.
Right.
That's wise advice.
I just read a story by a very nice new writer, good new writer. And he punctuated the shit out of it. You know, it's like in his first paragraph, again, he's a good writer, but his first paragraph, it was three sentences long. It had 10 commas and 2 parentheses. In 3 sentences. That stops your eye at every possible opportunity. I said, what the fuck did you do that for? You know, just tell the goddamn story. It's in the first paragraph, which is when you got to grab somebody and pull them in. I just went, oh, fuck, what is this? Went on a little bit, yeah, it picked up a bit. But that first paragraph, the first sentence, they've got to grab you. I mean, there's a book I read called Blonde. First line is I killed him. Huh? Who killed who? And is this true? Or you just want to know more? That's you gotta get the book. I think it can be a very long poetic book. It's gotta be beautiful, but it's gotta have that first
that first grabber. It's got to get to you. And this one just didn't. I said, hit a Paul, hit a comma after, before and after and. Stop! I can use a comma before or after and.
Hi, Linda. So economy applies to punctuation as much as everything else.
Oh yeah. Well, you know, I'm cranky. I don't use semicolons. I don't use colons. I use dashes and stuff. But I try to keep down to commas and periods as much as I can. Exclamation points only after in dialogue. Never in actual prose. Because I think it's distracting.
Yeah.
And we're. It's interesting to read books from the Melville era or Victorian era, where there's lots of colons and semicolons. They get, because they were so wonderful, they get you into that rhythm. But I don't think we read in that rhythm anymore much. We just don't. Maybe it's too bad, but it's just where we're at.
That's the way it is, yeah. By the way, if anyone has a question while we're talking, please feel free to raise your hand.
Yeah, don't wait for a Q&A at the end. Just something.
And if not yet, then what is your exercise in the book? That was your introductory essay about economy. That is important.
I forget.
Okay, right.
Cut the book. This is actually an excerpt of it. I did a class with the lid reactor, which I've done a couple of times, so I hope to do it fairly soon. And this is sort of an excerpt from one of those lectures on the reactor. And so the exercise was write an opening paragraph that starts in the middle of something. Make sure your first line is immediate and draws us right in. And that the paragraph that follows fulfills the promise of that line. This is not the time to go off on a tangent. This is the time to start singing your song. Second exercise was, write an opening paragraph using short staccato lines. Then write the same paragraph using runoffs. Reverse the process and write another. He's nodding his head, you're getting this. Okay. The notion is, I think first line and first paragraph are so important. No matter what kind of book it is, it can be a nonfiction book. It can be a poem. That first thing that hits you has got to make you want to stay for more. I think my most often quoted line is from The Girl Next Door. And that line is, you think you know about pain? I'm thinking that was a good line. I think that was a little inspired because it says a lot. It says that it's demanding you to engage in what's going to come next because he's saying, come on in. And then you know that he's experienced pain, or he thinks he has at least. And he's sort of challenging you to up that or even experience that. And it's the first line that brings you to the whole rest of the book, brings you to the paragraph. Call it the brief paragraph. Hoping with me, so I can't really tell you how that goes. I think people put that on t-shirts, so I guess it's pretty cool.
Yeah. And it's the perfect intro into that story. I mean, it really sets it up.
Yeah.
That is suffering that way.
So I agree with you that first lines are really, really important. I was wondering if you could share, not necessarily specifically a first line, but a book, because you've done a lot of books and a lot of short stories and poetry, that you worked a lot on the first line before you really felt you had nailed it.
That's a great question.
You invited me.
Careful what you wish for. Nothing is springing to mind, really, but I do know that I've very often gone over that first line, the first paragraph, even once I'm into it. And so that's not quite making it. You can get hung up on first paragraphs, or for that matter, last paragraphs. Mm-hmm. Last paragraphs also, they're summing up what you're doing, and my God, sometimes you get it wrong. When I wrote She Wakes, my last paragraph, ate shit, it was horrible. But I was on a deadline, I had to get it in. And when I later was able to rewrite it, I took out not only the first paragraph, I took out the entire chapter and wrote it. So I can't really, no. Often I don't think I could start by what I've got the first line.
So that's really, and for you, energetically, that's what you
secure,
that's your entree,
it's the
you spend your time there.
Yeah.
Have you ever written the first line and really felt strongly about it and then kept going? And had the payoff, as you said, and then come back and go, wait a minute, now I don't like the first, you know, it's like almost that it took you in a whole nother direction, and the first line didn't feel so strong as it did originally.
No.
Feel strong.
I have to say no. Because by the time I'm halfway into whatever I'm writing, I've worked. The way I write basically is, whether it's a long story or short stories, I'll write what I wrote right that day. Then I'll go back over what I wrote the day before I go on to do anything else. That means I'm doing a first draft instead of a rough draft. And often, during that process, because I'm doing that every day, I'll go back to the very beginning again and see if they all fit. So in other words, I'm not just writing new stuff every day. A lot of guys do that and they like that process. I don't. I need to go back and make it sound right. I like to make the rhythms correct, and that means going back to the beginning sometimes, or the way to the beginning sometimes, even in a novel, not just a short story. So.
Do you often use commas to enforce rhythm or to plot it?
To do what?
Do you often use commas for rhythm and punctuation?
Yeah, I'm more likely to use omit commas for rhythm. For instance, I never put a comma before or after an and or a but. I want that run. You know? I'm more likely to use a period and break the. So he said, I didn't do it. You know, I prefer that jagged kind of line. So either I'm going to write a big. Nasty line, you gotta follow because I'm racing through it, or I'm gonna chop you up and make you pay attention to those ends of stops, you know, end stop periods. So, yeah, commas are my commas and periods are my favorite punctuations.
So that's interesting. It sounded like what you just said there was that the longer sentences are meant to kind of quicken the pace.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, like, what are your strategies for kind of delving into kind of a longer sentence rather than a shorter staccato.
Let me go back to this. Right. And I think I can answer that pretty well. Just by sort of dissecting. We lost our place.
Yes, but I know where it is.
Here's how it's punctuated. So it's all pouring out of him now, comma. He's all over the place, comma. We're done with the weather and the small talk, comma. It's like I've set something loose inside him, which he says he's not spoken of in 25 years, and maybe it's his own three scotches to my one, but I think it runs much deeper than that, period. I think he's speaking about who he is and why. Okay, here's the strategy. Comma after now, he's all pouring out of now, he's all over the place, comma. We're done with the weather and small talk, comma. That's it. Those three commas, that's it. The rest of it is one great big long run-on line until I blank it, I stop it, and I say, I think he's speaking about who he is. If you look at it, it really makes sense to you. Because that is.
And those commas, they could have been period, those first three commas.
They could have been. Yeah.
But you really had a strategy with that.
Yeah.
Sentence.
Yeah.
That's
it's. It's so much fun to do this shit.
Let's go. I have a question.
Okay.
Which is a little bit bigger picture. picture on economy. I really appreciate the topic as more of a screenwriter, and I've learned so much about making things tight and challenging myself kind of later on.
Yeah.
I want to ask you about the woman, is that
the
woman?
Yeah.
No, Ladies Night.
Okay.
Ladies Night. What did you learn about economy from
Ladies
that
Night is not a movie.
No, but it's a book. But you
yeah.
learned something about economy from that, from working with it, from an outline to a big long version to narrowing it down.
Oh, yeah, I forgot, that's true. Ladies Night was going to be my second book. Off Season was my first. And it was a typing novel, about 150 pages. And Valentine loved it, and they said, you know, man, we're going to beat the shit out of this publicity wise. And this is like, I've never seen anything with quite this many teeth before. So we're going to exploit that, and you're going to get promotions, banners, and all kinds of stuff. Well,
this is Off Season.
This is Off Season, the first one. Ladies and I was the follow-up to that, which they wanted to be my, if Off Season was Carrie, they wanted Ladies and I to be my Salem Star. Bigger, more of the same, you know, but you know, on a bigger scale and scope. And so I wrote a 30-page, because I was the first kind of writer, I think I wrote like a 30-page expression of what it was going to be in the first chapter. And I honed that out. They bought it, and Valentine said, we're good at this. And I hated it, because I felt locked into all that outline that I'd sort of set free in the world, and I really didn't like the mural, and it became like just big, messy book. They rejected it, but they didn't reject it because they hated it, they rejected it because Off Season was pissing people off all over the place. And
they took the
CEO of Random House to task for publishing violent pornography. So I got buried, and the book got buried, and Valentine asked me for a refund on the advance. I got myself an agent who was actually my ex-boss at the CEO. He said, nah, he's going to write a third novel, you're going to buy that, and you're going to add $1,000 to the pot. It was $10,000 to the pot. And I said, okay, I'll do that. So Ladies and I just went, bye. And I wrote this thing called Hide and Seek, which is another short little novel. But it was quieter, and they were able to not be offended by it. But that was the last I ever saw about. So then that sat down for years. And because Ladies Night, I thought, a pretty good idea, years later, I wrote a screenplay based on it, which meant that I cut a whole lot of it out. And I had subplots up the wazoo. I had the federal government coming into it. It's about a night when every woman in Manhattan was completely crazy. You know, there was a chemical spill in the middle of Manhattan, and the women go fucking nuts. And it's the war between men and women, everybody's shooting. So it was a cool idea, I thought. It's a good idea. It gave me lots of subtext about the wars between men and women in various kinds of ways. But it was just overblown, it was a mess. So I did the screenplay and cut it down a bit. And it's still, the screenplay itself. But then years later, I was asked to do a novella. And so I took the screenplay, and I took the screenplay and the other book, and I cut the shit out of the other book, and put together, I think, a pretty nice little tight novel. And yes, it was tight. The whole thing is just cut out all the elegant titles in the original script.
Did you have to buy the original book back?
No.
Did they give it to you?
No, Jack gave me a good deal. He said, he's keeping it, man. He delivered exactly what you asked for. And just because you don't like where it's gone, just because you don't like the fact that you're getting bad shit from your distributors, he fulfilled the contract. Mm-hmm. So, business of writing. No, entirely.
Well, then let's talk more about that.
Do you ever you're talking about the subtext, right, with influencing and how that, when you're talking about Ladies Night, you have all these ideas for subtext.
Right.
Do do you find that the subtext, you're so into that, that it somehow it challenges the arc or the, like you're,
Yeah. I'm having a problem with that now. I'm writing another book with a book and movie with Lucky McKee, I did the one with him, I did on the sound with him. But we've been doing, we've done instant nails. This is how we work. We instant nail back and forth about an hour a day. Mm-hmm. Hour a day is about what we can do before we break down. Mm-hmm. But we're bouncing all these ideas with. And as I said, we've got like 25, 27 hours logged in on this. We've hit so many subtexts and so many different places. I finally said to him last week, we've got to do an actual graph of how this flows, because we've got things, balloons flying away all over the place. And we're doing that now. And it's interesting, it's fun to do, because you're killing some of your children. You know, it's a great idea, but and what sounded really good on day two doesn't sound good on day 29. So, yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, you have to learn how to burn bridges. Yeah.
So connected with that, it could be connected with thematic things, like having too many themes or too many things you're trying to say in one story. I have that problem
sometimes.
Sometimes I'm getting over it.
No, I think I'm pretty. I think we're pretty. Again, I'm going back to what Lucky and I are doing. We basically have three things we want to deal with, and those three things have stayed stable. And when I'm doing my own stuff, there's usually only one theme, maybe some overlapping ones. I mean, but this one sort of major one. For instance, The Girl Next Door. There's a bunch of stuff going on. There's violence toward children. Violence against women, against women, hatred of your own sex, letting the community in on your pain. There's all kinds of stuff going on. The main thing is, hey, you're hurting this person for no reason at all.
Different kinds of pain.
So yeah, so there are things that swirl around that, and you sort of focus in on the main thing that you really try to say. And then other ideas, other social ideas, climb in there at some point. That's great. Extra fun.
Thank you. It's ready. Okay, not really about economy, but I'm always curious with a writer like you. You seem to be very drawn to the dark side of human experience. A lot of it is real world, the shadow, the stuff most of us don't want to look at in the world or in ourselves.
Right.
Is this something that you found you were drawn to early on?
Oh, yeah. I don't remember who said this. He said, as a writer, he said, we're all wounded, but that's good for a writer. When I was a kid, I had dark fantasies, and I was a troubled child. I was writing from, I think I started writing really back by the program, like the Knights and Soldiers, making plots and things like that. So conflict was always in my brain. Being an only child in a warring family does that to me. So that's always been there. And I've always written, I think at some point, at some point I decided I wanted to try for God. Which I guess was about trying to find forgiveness or something, because something I wasn't doing that maybe I could have made my parents and my life better. And so I searched. I was a Methodist. I was a Lutheran. I was a fucking Catholic for a while. I got involved with a Jew. I did everything I could possibly do to find God. And I finally said, you know, you can remake yourself just by remaking yourself. You don't need this other. And my life got straighter and saner after that. But that early on stuff, the pain of you know being looking for that. I mean, I had a Jesus complex for a while. I sort of wanted to die for everybody's sins. It was pretty weird. Have you ever said that? Love it.
This
is the first.
Yeah. Writing about this
and you know what?
Stuff,
you know
doing
what?
It for other people.
You know what I said? I said to myself at some point,
fuck that. Do you find that this kind of writing, this kind of topics, it's healing for you? Because I think it could be healing.
It's better than healing, it's fun.
For people.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's really great when you know you've got what you want to say down there, and you've got it down the best way you possibly can. It's immensely gratifying. You know that there's probably people out there who do it better than you, but you gave it your fucking best shot, and you sit back and go, I'm smiling now. This is perfect. I said what I wanted to say, and I said it well.
That's the pleasure of writing.
It is.
And maybe you're uniquely qualified to write this kind of stuff. It almost seems like you have compassion for both sides,
sure,
the victims and the perpetrators. Is that?
I start with
that
the victims. I always start with the victims. I know we need to know who my people are, who's getting it hurt, and why. And then the rest of it comes out of that. I'm really writing about succeeding, about overcoming things that you think you can overcome. Just a short story about somebody who has cancer and overcoming the cancer, or at least dealing with it well. I'm kind of optimistic.
Yeah, I was gonna say you're a cockeyed optimist.
Yeah, kind of.
In disguise, maybe.
I'm also a certain age. I'm also a certain age. I think a lot of us ex-hippies are failed romantics. The romantic's still in there.
Yeah.
We still want the world to be living in peace, love, and happiness. And so that creeps into my shit all the time.
So that's a curmudgeon, I guess. I'm not saying you are. But.
Oh, no. I'm not a curmudgeon. Oh,
a curmudgeon is
curmudgeon. He's delightful, but he's a curmudgeon.
A curmudgeon is a disillusioned romantic, but you
yeah.
are a romantic.
I am, I guess.
Underneath it all.
I just published a book of poetry called Notes from the Cat House. and most of my
it's, a cat
it's called that because most of the poems are about cats.
The soft and cuddly. Oh, you're right.
There's not a drop of blood in the entire poetry. I
love it.
I guess going off what we were talking about a little bit before about writing about dark things, I guess my first question is, does what you write ever scare you?
Yeah. In fact, if it doesn't scare me, I don't want to write it. I really have to entertain that fear. Yeah. And it's the same though with writing about sex or love or a friendship. You've got to feel the feeling before you can actually translate it. So yeah, I mean, I want to scare my ass off whenever it possibly can.
And then my follow-up would be, what have you ever found that what you're capable of writing has ever scared you?
In The Girl Next Door, there's a sequence where it's a one-line chapter, and it says basically something like, I'm not going to tell you about this. There's some things I shouldn't talk about. And I see that. I see the scene. I see what he's thinking and what he's seeing. But I don't want to write it down. I don't want you to have to look at it. I looked at it, and I will do it.
Thank you.
That was good. But I try not to do that too often. I try to get in on it so you can feel it. It's only when it's over the top that I'll say, anybody else? No, I'm dying.
When you're writing, do you ever encounter your character surprising you? Like,
yeah.
It's gonna go this way and they're like,
oh, yeah.
It's not.
Oh yeah. I'll think somebody's gonna live at the end and they die. Or vice versa. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. At the end of one of my books, I thought I'm going to have a happy ending, and the guy has cancer at the end. And it still, weirdly enough, has a happy ending. It's called Red. But I had no idea that was going to happen. And it's at some point, it's really strange when you're doing a novel, especially, and your characters start to take on their own lives, and they dictate to you what they're supposed to, what you're supposed to do. It's like, okay, I'm obeying you now. You fucking have cancer. Sorry. It's just, I had no idea I was going to do that. No idea. Yeah.
Did you ever used to fight it at first, or did you?
Oh no, 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 no. The instinct is to go with it. Yeah, you're on board and just, you know, just go with it. Yeah, it's fun.
Following up on the dark side question, do you find that your friends or people in your life, well, I think this is...
They shun me.
Yeah, that was what I was going to ask. Are they afraid, like, where that is within you, or, like, where's this coming from, and then do they go for the, I mean, it'd be kind of strange, but is any part of them in there? In other words, they say, well, just, and do you really think that of me kind of thing, you know?
No, that's two questions, I think. Yeah.
Yes.
So the first question is, do I scare my friends?
Yes.
Until we get to know me. Yeah. It's fun to go to conventions and have, you know, people come for signs and stuff. And sometimes I come up to them and go, who's to mention that? Sit down, sign your damn book, you know? So yeah, that definitely happens. And the second part was, what about?
About them, once they get to know you and they're actually accepting of, do they find, do they, because people always want to know, are they in your writing? And if your writing is so scary, you know, or what?
If I write about somebody, I let them know before I publish it. If there's somebody who's I'm going to reference, I'll ask them if it's okay to do this. The main thing, what springs to mind, that is Red. Red, the backstory to my main character, Red, was a very tragic occurrence that happened with a friend of mine who was a painter. And his wife and his son were killed by his other son. And I wanted to get that in the story because it seemed like perfect for that particular character's backstory. But I emailed Neil and I said, this is what I'd like to do. Can I try it? He said, go for it. And then when I wrote it, I sent back to it again, basically, as much. So I think you really have to be able to do that. So.
Yeah. I have a question I don't even know if you can answer, but you know, there's a lot of authors who have, after having, you know, written a lot of work, and you've done a lot of work, sort of seem disenchanted to me. Disconnected or they've lost the fun of it. And like, how do you keep it?
Well, you get older, you don't work quite as hard as often. So it's like, you know, it's a Robert Mitchum said, I said, you know, how come, you know, you don't make any movie, a lot of movies? He said, every now and then I just drop out that way, I'm the new girl in the horror house. I think there's something to that. I don't push myself to write. I did for a long, long time. And I don't take science that I don't want, that I don't feel like I need it. Mm-hmm. But then when something does come along, I'm 100% behind it because it's just out of my brain and it seems like right, and it's fun. I think the key is fun. If it's not funny, well, don't do it. Don't write some novella because you're asked to do it. Don't write for hire because you make the money because of like that. Writing is high level fun. It's play. And if you lose the sense of play, you should stop. Philip Roth is not going to write anymore. I miss that because I love his books. I've read everything he's ever written. But he decided he's done. I buy that. Get out while you're ahead. While you still have something that you said.
I think it might have something to do with also not putting limitations on yourself. You don't put limitations on yourself as far as genre, movie, medium, or anything, and that is what is part of
that
the fun.
That helps. That's right. I bounce back between nonfiction, fiction, as I said, poetry every now and then, mostly for myself, screenwriting. It's good to be involved in various different forms. You can't have a novel idea every day. It's just...
And you may
may not want to work on something that's
yeah,
so massive.
Yeah, you don't want to marry that person. So.
Yeah. You just want to date for
yeah,
the
yeah, story. Yeah, I wouldn't want that stand here, thank you.
That would be a poem, I guess.
Well, how short the one stand is.
Some poems are a few pages. But
maybe why am I could.
My God, are you taping this?
He's
ah, yes.
He's written some
good. That was a good night I could.
Memorable.
Yeah. Second line.
I think that's part of it. You follow your heart, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To what intrigues you. And your mind, I guess.
And if you're lucky, you're not pushed to it. You know, I started out at a really good time to begin writing. There's a lot of openings for fiction writers. Nance magazines, Rock and Roll magazines, all that stuff. It was a lot of things to get in and learn your chops while you were getting paid. And so that was pretty cool. And I've been lucky that way.
Yeah, that's a good time. That's
yeah.
Not the case.
You
never
have to start too hard.
Good for you. What other writing advice would you share with other writers?
Robert Bloch told me that if you don't eat, you don't. That's a pretty good piece of advice. Unless it's really something that's driving you, don't do it. Don't do it because you think you can make money because you're crazy. Don't start too big. Don't think that you should write your first novel before you write your first short story. Take your time. Learn. Study. Grab all the big, good guys and eat them up and steal from them and try to make them your own. Take their looks like a rock and roll guitarist and make them your own. And then when you're ready to do it, write about something that matters. That's not just entertainment, that has something in you that you want to communicate to the world, to others. It can be great fun. It can be great fun, but it should have some usefulness beyond just the fact that it's what's up.
What's it like working with a co-writer like Luke Monkey? Do you ever have like severe disagreements? I noticed
no.
There was some strangeness with the end of I'm Not Sam.
Oh yeah.
Was there a fight?
What do you mean strangeness?
Well, he said wait for a day before you.
Oh yeah, no, that was agreed upon as well.
Yeah.
No, I don't know. This I don't guess I've read this, but basically it was a piece that Lucky and I did together, thinking it was going to be a book and a movie at the same time. And I wrote the prose version first. And we realized, yeah, we've got the entire thing for the novella. It works, it's complete, it works, but the exigencies of a film are that you've got a first act, a second act, and a third act. Well, in our third act, quote, in the book, was like, it's all fuck. So the thing about, okay, wait, hold on, we've got to write a third act, we're going to do a movie. What we decided to do is do an entirely different short story from the other person's point of view, and that would be the third act of the film. And it also made a really cool coda to I'm Not Sam, the novella. We had a blast doing that, and we're having a blast doing this. I'm probably 30 years older than he is, but we have a great deal in common in terms of sensibilities. We like the same stuff. We're both on the same page as what we're going to do emotionally. We're not just out to scare you. We're out to like to talk to you about something. So yeah, it was great. And we came to that point, I'm like, oh fuck. We didn't get through that. And it was just a couple of days. We just really good. Good fun. Yeah.
How do you get through periods of your writing that are not fun, like writer's block, or how do you keep yourself motivated?
I don't believe in writer's block. I believe that I'm lazy, often. I don't have any really great ideas, often. I don't consider a writer's block. I mean, maybe I've got something emotional that's going on in my life, and I don't want to deal with it. to deal with writing. I think that's all well and good, but I don't blame it on writer's block. Writer's block is usually about excuses for emotional situations. Are you drinking too much? Is that your writer's block? Sorry, don't wear the Jamesons. I guess in the broader sense, I'm patient. I sort of wait for the ideas to come to me. I don't chase them down. When I was young, I did chase them down, for better or worse. But I think this stuff comes to you or it doesn't. The best stuff comes to you or it doesn't. You can write, I'll still write some trivia, basically. And every now and then I'll dip into some comedy or something like that, just for fun. Or I'll write a poem just for fun. But the major stuff comes to you and says you've got to write me. Do it. You're a writer, that's what you're supposed to do. So fucking write me.
I don't know, I came in a little late, so I don't want you to repeat it, but did you talk about, like, if you...
We missed the whole sex part.
I'm gonna need pictures, movies. Anyway, did you talk about if you're a writer that's been doing shorter work and now you're approaching the novel, advice that you would give, for instance, example is that Rick Hodula or Joe Lansing were both talking about writing novels for, you know, someone not doing it, and they had talked about approaching each chapter like a short story. What's the beginning of the story, what's the middle of the story, what's the end of the story? And not worrying in your first go through whether that story is going to feed the end, blah, 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 because you already should have a concept of that. You know, because I think a novel can be a scary landscape if you haven't done it a lot, if you've been doing short things. So do you have any thing in your pocket that you would give someone who's just jumping into the novel pool?
No, that's sort of what you're doing.
It is what I do.
I think that with a novel, each chapter is kind of a short story, but it doesn't have to have a resolution. Mm-hmm. It can be a hanger.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in that sense, it's like a short story. You've got the beginning, you've got the middle, and you've got the hanger. But that's got to lead to something else that gets you to the next hanger. And I'm not talking about like major cliffhangers either. I'm just talking about the way the prose runs. I don't know, dear. It's like everything, all form is beginning, middle, and end. It's the basic three. Everything happens in threes in writing, as far as I'm concerned. Get the beginning, middle, and end, first act, second act, third act. And a poem has that. You've got the beginning, you've got the engagement, you've got the end. That's at the end. With writing chapters, it's kind of the same thing. It's kind of the same thing. Read any really good novelist, and you go, oh my god, that chapter began exactly when it's supposed to. Filled me in on some information and then led me somewhere else. Does that help?
Yes.
Okay.
From a business perspective, we were talking about when your agent and you know, the business side, and now that you've worked in or done successful in different medium,
yeah.
Which is hardest to do? Book, film, in terms of the dealing with the people's
business?
Well, in terms of shutting down your voice or trying to, you know, make your voice fit their expectation.
I don't do that at all. Anyone. I did when I first started. I just, if you don't like it, don't buy it. Go away. I don't know if that
answers your question. Oh, yeah.
Is there anything that you really care about that you haven't written about yet?
There's a story that I'm afraid to write because I don't want to move the subject matter that long. And I may write it someday, or I may write a small version of it someday. But it's just, you know, you live with dark stuff, and that means that you engage that emotionally And there are just some things I don't want to replay in my mind over and over enough to really want to write it. And this is one particular story that I just may never write. It's about animal abuse. And it'll make a good story, I think. I just don't know if I've ever have to actually live with that shit at home.
So how do you feel about other things that are really hard, like Girl Next Door? I would think that would be, and a lot of your stuff, I think it would be hard to.
A lot of that was hard to do, but it's, I don't know what it's about, this particular thing that really gets me. It's maybe because it's so pervasive and it's hard to pin down. With the Girl Next Door, with most of the things that I've dealt with, and the only child is also that deals with child abuse. It's about a single case. It's about one thing that I can sort of focus in on, and I can illuminate the case, and I can illuminate who the bad guy is and who the good guys are. With this, the story that I think I want to tell, there's so fucking many bad guys. I don't know who to start.
It's overwhelming.
Yeah. It's kind of overwhelming. Yeah. Yeah. We'll see. I may get the balls of that sooner or later. But that's the only thing I can think of. I have no time to lose.
Apparently not. Is that advice that you would give to any writer?
Your taboos are going to be your own. But as far as I'm concerned, I want to hear what you got to say about the worst shit you got to say. Yeah.
Break through. That's maybe part of the job for the writer, for the culture, is
break
to break through.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Anybody else have a question? I have something else that's personal for me. You were talking about how to go for you were talking about how to go from a short story to a novel. Do you have any advice for me as a screenwriter taking a screenplay to a novel, making it less economical, at least in number of words?
Well, a screenplay and a novella are about the same size. They're about the same size. Think about that. Think about every novella you read that you think is a screenplay. They're about the same size in terms of length. There's the sense of being compact, not being sprawling, dotted tart, could not have written the gold finch as a novella. It's not possible. By the way, good win, I think. Pulitzer got to a good person. It's a great book. I think that there's that. I guess you just have to worry about not overblowing the damn thing into a novel size. Think about novellas. You know, we talk about novellas, and in the old days, Raymond Chandler, Dashiell Hammett would have been writing novellas because they were 150 pages long. That's nonsense. They were novels. You know, I've got people ask me how many novels I've written. I said, depends on how many pages you write. Because, I can tell you 13, I can tell you 20. So, it's a ridiculous marketing thing that's been laid on us over the years. It truly has nothing to do with what's packed into those things.
That is really good advice, because all I really need to do is fill in things that I personally feel like I would have enjoyed putting into the screen, where I'm expecting an actor to give or director to give. I can put that in there without going crazy.
You're expanding on the screenplay, you're expanding, you're going internal, which you can't do in the screenplay. Screenplay is just sight and sound.
Right.
Where you do all kinds of stuff.
Thank you.
She's looking happy.
No, we're at our time.
Thank you.
Last words.